gonna break. Oh, I couldn't stop it, tried to slow it all down. Crying in the bathroom, had to figure it out. With everyone around me saying, you must be so happy now. Oh, you keep reaching.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I think we'll go ahead and get started. My name is Kylie Taylor, and I am the Wyoming State Coordinator for Conservatives Concerned About the Death Penalty. I am also a part of the Wyoming campaign to end the death penalty, as well as Christal Martin is in that campaign as well, or that coalition. Our coalition is, for those who don't know, is a very diverse group of individuals from around Wyoming who all come at repealing the death penalty with a common goal. What's really fascinating about our coalition is that we all kind of disagree on other policy issues, but the one thing that we all can come together on and agree on is repealing the death penalty, which I think is really important to recognize when talking about this issue, that it's that important that we all can come together on it. I'm really, really excited for tonight's event. Some of you have virtually met Christal Martin before, but we also have Sue DeBree with us as well. And I'm excited for everyone to get to know her and her amazing personality, and also hear from Christal too, of course. So we are, at the end of this, we're gonna open it up for questions. And my colleague, Sarah, will, once we wrap up, we'll go over how we're gonna do Q&A at the end. And also Sarah is listed as admin/help. So if you have any questions or need any help throughout the duration of this event, please message her so that she can help you out. So we are going to get started with Christal. Christal Martin was born and raised in Wyoming. She is the executive director and co-founder of Sweetwater Against Trafficking. Christal started Sweetwater Against Trafficking to provide a local resource to fight against human trafficking and exploitation. She is also the president of the Wyoming Restorative Justice Council and is a part of the Wyoming campaign to end the death penalty. Christal got involved with restorative justice after studying criminal justice and has made it her responsibility to ensure the community is a safe place for everyone. So Christal, whenever you are ready, go ahead.
Thank you. What a great introduction. So as they said, or as Kylie said, I'm Christal Martin, and I was a two-time family member of murder victims. And the first one started in 1993 when my mother was kidnapped and raped and murdered. I was 8 years old, and watching my dad have to go through the type of pain that he went through and knowing the type of pain that I went through, it was almost unbearable. We ended up having some severe issues as a teenager, and I had to be sent away to several different treatment facilities and go to counseling. So it was just a very long process. And I know by the end of the trial, sentencing for the death penalty wouldn't have been impactful for anybody. Morally, my dad never agreed with the death penalty, but also it just would have been a longer process and more traumatic for him to have to go through as an adult. So when I was about, I want to say 26 years old, my mother's offender was up for a parole hearing, because in the state of Wyoming, they were allowed to have a parole hearing after serving 10 years of their sentence. He did have five life consecutive sentences, and he was seen by the parole board. I saw them through Zoom, and I realized that I was trying to convince the parole board that I had forgiven this man, and got in the shower after the call and just cried my eyes out and didn't know what true forgiveness was. So it was my mission at that point in time to figure out what is forgiveness. I started criminal justice school shortly after that, and through school, I came across this assignment that had to do with restorative justice. So I decided to use myself as a experimental tool and go and meet with the offender. And at that point in time, I knew that I had felt forgiveness. Shortly before that, I had actually lost my husband in October of 2014. He was shot in the head and burned in a fire pit by his boss under a meth-induced psychosis, where both of them had been using meth that day, and paranoia kicked in. When I first found out about my husband's death, I had the normal coping emotions of hatred, anguish, resentment. I wanted anything and everything I possibly could against this man, but then later figured out that I did not want this man to die. This man had a five-year-old daughter and a wife and family, and I didn't want them to be victimized by losing a family member just as our family had. So I had made it my mission to start working on restorative justice and to help empower victims to have a voice and to be heard, so that their stories didn't get misconstrued, but also to help the offenders' families so that they didn't have to have the same kind of pain that us victims did. And that is pretty much my story.
Sorry, I was on mute. Thank you, Christal. I appreciate you sharing your story and how powerful it is. I swear, I've heard you tell that story so many times, and it still just breaks my heart every single time you tell it again. So thank you for being so brave and sharing that with all of us. It means a lot to me, and I'm sure that it does to everyone else that's on this call as well. Next, I'd like to introduce Sue. Sue DeBree grew up in Montana, where she was, an elementary education teacher. In 2002, Sue was appointed to serve the United Methodist Congregations of Buffalo and Casey, Wyoming. In those years, she was elected president of the Wyoming Association of Churches. Sue has always been active within her congregation and is now fully retired in Montana, where she can play with her great-grandchildren and stay involved with the legislature as opportunities arise. whenever you're ready, Sue.
Thank you, Kylie. And it's just been a real joy and privilege to get to be connected to Wyoming in this way. And I left a big part of my heart down there. We raised our family on a ranch out of Helena here, and it was a big quilted family. I like to use that word instead of blended because it's more true. Well, all these different pieces get stitched together. And I taught school and worked in the county health department here for a number of years. And then when my children were pretty much grown, I followed a call into ministry in the United Methodist Church. And that call took me to Denver for a master's degree there in divinity that's required by our church. And my first appointment was the first church in Cheyenne as the associate pastor for First United Methodist Church there. So that was back in 1990, and I spent 3 years in Cheyenne. I had been in Cheyenne for 1 month in my first appointment when we received a call that my firstborn daughter, the child that I brought into our big family, had been shot and killed in Great Falls. And we knew that there was a long history of domestic violence in her situation, and we didn't ever really get clear answers on what happened. For various reasons, it wasn't ever investigated appropriately. And this is not just my opinion, but we had private investigators look through things, and we worked quite extensively through all of this, and eventually had to come to a sense of forgiveness, as Crystal's talked about. Either this incident and her loss and the injustice that came about following that is going to dominate my life, or I'm going to find a way to keep moving on so I can be there for my other children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. So it was a hard choice and took a lot of support from the church in Cheyenne. I've made friends there that I'm still connected with and love deeply. And I was down there a year ago and got a tour of the new Capitol building with all of the renovation there. And it's just a gem. You did a great job. It's beautiful. So many really deep memories. And then in my time serving churches in Wyoming, both in Cheyenne and in Buffalo and KC, I was connected to the Wyoming Association of Churches. And as Kylie mentioned, was able to serve as president for a couple of years of that and traveled around the state a lot. And in that connection, we offered worship services for the legislature and got to visit and be part of things there under that circumstance. And also, both with the Wyoming Association of Churches and the Montana Association of Churches, have represented the different denominations that make up those bodies, who all have a stand against the death penalty. So United Methodists and Episcopalians, American Baptists, Roman Catholics, ELCA Lutheran, UCC, I know I'm not getting everybody, Presbyterian, all of those different churches, within their statements of their social principles or the equivalent, have stands against the death penalty. And that comes from our faith traditions and from our experience living in the world, that this has not been shown to actually have much of a deterrence for the crimes of passion that happen. Things happen fast and quick and swift, and people are out of control, like Crystal mentioned, with the meth or some other circumstances so often. With the situation of my daughter, there was drug use involved too. And I know domestic violence can happen in a totally straight, sober situation too, but that just increases the possibility of things getting out of control. And so when in Wyoming, in Buffalo, I was part of the domestic violence shelter board and worked with people there and heard so many different people's stories and how for so many of us, if the perpetrator had been put to death too, it would not have resolved our grief, really. That's not something for most of us that would bring whatever closure is. It's knowing that there would be another family that would be grieving as we have. And it's believing that taking a life to resolve a conflict is not the answer. It's not the answer for us individuals in our homes. It's not the answer for our states too, because when our state is a reflection of the values that we hold, and if we keep executing people because that's the solution, in a way it kind of legitimizes people taking a life to solve a problem. It's a pattern. Our governments, they set the values. They reflect the values, and they also model the values that we want to live by. And so we have this responsibility to set a higher standard for how we solve our conflicts, how we resolve our problems. I really like what Christal's saying about the restorative justice and that whole concept. I've learned a lot about that, and I really, really appreciate it. I've worked with the Montana legislature ever since my daughter's death to try to bring about changes here. And as you know, it's not easy. I had one guy at the last round say, "Aren't you guys ever going to go away?" And I said, "No," because we really believe that that this death penalty stuff needs to go away. And I'm not going away until it does. So get used to me. It's just a flawed logic, I think, to keep killing people to tell people that they shouldn't kill people. So one other thing I'd really like to express too is that when I was serving the church in Butte for 9 years, we were live radio every Sunday morning, way before Zoom. We were out there on the radio and had a regular broadcast of our worship service. And there was a group in the state penitentiary in Deer Lodge that consistently listened to the worship service. They communicated with me. We'd write letters back and forth once a month or so, asking questions, trying to understand their faith better, to try to live into it. There were people in that group that were going to be in prison for the rest of their lives for whatever different crimes they had done. And yet God wasn't done with them yet. From within the prison, their lives had been changed. Their faith had grown. Their desire to try to bring about some kind of restoration, to try to make some kind of amends, was very real. And that would have all been cut off if their lives had been cut short. There was also a person who was part of the pre-release center who had killed a business partner. And had not been given life, but as he made his way back into society, he and his wife would come and worship with us. And he did all kinds of great things to just help the old church building hold together. And to see him kneeling at the communion rail next to a captain in our police department and them passing the bread and the cup to each other, to me, that was a glimpse of the kingdom of God. Every time we did that. And I truly believe, because I've seen it in real life, that the possibility of restoration even if they never ever get out of prison, that there is a chance for life to have meaning and purpose and be a life of faith and be sharing that love of God in Christ. There's no place that we can go beyond that love. That's pretty much what I'd like to share, but thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Sue. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Sue.
Before we move on to Q&A from those in attendance, I wanted to circle back to you, Christal, and just ask you what it would mean for you as a murder victim's family member twice, what it would mean for you to see the death penalty in Wyoming repealed, sorry.
So for myself, after doing so much research on the death penalty and just knowing from a victim's perspective, we see such a high population of nonviolent drug offenders. We see, a smaller percentage of violent offenders in the prison systems. And we see a high rate of recidivism. Within the first 3 years, I believe it was rated at like 65%, and then it just goes up in 5 years. And please don't quote me, because it's been a long time since I wrote a report on that. But what we're not doing is we are not looking at the trauma impact of most offenders that are in the penitentiaries. We are not seeing an individual and looking at their adverse childhood experiences, their mental health issues. We are not trying to help heal from within and help them reintegrate into society. So for me, repealing the death penalty would mean that money can go to programs to help ensure the health and well-being of those offenders that are really struggling, that want the help, that want to go out and be a productive citizen, and not just have to live in that prison pipeline for the rest of their life and commit worse and worse crimes after they get out.
Absolutely. You touched on a really good point about the money that is spent on the death penalty. And particularly in Wyoming, we are spending a lot of money as taxpayers and not getting anything in return. We don't currently have anyone on death row, and we haven't executed anyone since 1992, yet taxpayers are still spending money every year just to keep it as a law in the books. And I think that that's something that it's really, a lot of people don't know that. And I think it's important for taxpayers to acknowledge that and acknowledge that it's a waste of money for us. And that money, like you said, Christal, could be used towards programs that actually keep our community safe and prevent violence before it occurs. So that's, I'm glad that you touched on that, because that's really important to acknowledge. So if you'd like to ask a question, there are a couple of ways that you can do that. Feel free to use the Q&A or the chat feature to write it out. You can also raise your hand, use the raise your hand function, and Sarah will allow you to verbally ask your question of one of the panelists. So we can go ahead and get started with Q&A from those in attendance.
Kylie, I'm not seeing any questions right away. Do you want to go ahead and ask our panelists a couple of questions that have come up?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm going to come back to you, Christal, because I always love hearing about your experience with restorative justice. And I think it would be, if you're comfortable sharing, I think it would be powerful for those in attendance to hear about your story with meeting both the man who murdered your mother and your husband, because I think that that's really powerful.
Okay. So
as long as you're comfortable, don't feel pressure, just as long as you're comfortable answering.
Oh no, I'm extremely comfortable. I'm open book. So the first time I walked into the penitentiary with my mother's offender, I remember being so nervous. I was walking in with my mediator after a year of preparation and finally feeling like I've worked through a lot of the harm through that preparation. And so I'm walking through the prison and the doors are slamming behind me and my nerves are just jolting. Oh my gosh, you know, what's going to happen? I don't know this man. I've never seen this man, you know, other than pictures and reading about him. So when I go in, I felt empowered. I felt like, okay, this is my voice. I get to be heard for the first time. I get to answer or have the answers to my questions finally talked about. I get to be the lead of this conversation. You know, it started off with me actually reading a letter that I had written to him. And, you know, just the process that I had gone through the past year. And, you know, trying to understand an offender at a personal level is an extremely hard thing. But there was one point where he was talking about one of his lived experiences. And I saw in his eyes the pain. And I remember crying for him because I could see my children through his eyes and the children of the world that struggle and could have been in that situation at any point. We spoke for about 2.5 hours. And by the time I got out of that mediation, I felt like I was on cloud nine. I felt like that piece had been completely healed. Then I recently just finished up my mediation with Scott Cambry. And on my way, I have to tell you, my dad, I called him and I was a ball of nerves. I was bawling my eyes out because for the first time, I was going to have closure with my husband's murder. And it was like a chapter closing. And I remember calling my dad and I was like, I'm going to see Scott. And he's like, who's Scott? I said, oh, that's Wesley's offender. He asked me, he goes, why do you call him by his first name? And I said, well, because he's a person too.
Love you, Mom.
You know, he is a, he's a human being. He made a mistake and, you know, he has a name. He's not just a label. He's not just an offender. He's got a name. And I thought about that comment the whole time I was driving and I thought about that closure. But then I got there and he was able to read his letter first. And he had talked about some really key points with that. And one of them was that he didn't just impact one family, he impacted two families. And with Scott's sentencing, he got 45 years with the possibility of parole after 21 and a half. So my main mission and goal was to talk with him about what his plans were when he got out, what kind of services was he going to work towards so he could be a successful citizen when he gets out, and what is he doing to help with the socialization factors in the penitentiary that is what, average of 3 years to be socialized into criminal thinking behaviors. So he had mentioned his daughter, he had mentioned my children, and he had mentioned all of Wesley's family and then myself and then also his family. And I almost lost it because I realized that in a deeper level, they also are impacted. And most times offenders, family members are blamed for the offense versus just the person that carried out the offense. So we had a great conversation. I read him my letter and I cried my eyes out the entire time and he was just sobbing. He is actually in a theology program now and he will be graduating with his bachelor's and then he is going into personal or mental health or something that he'll be able to graduate with a bachelor's in that as well. But his main mission when he gets out is to make a difference in the community and to help others not go down the same path and fall under the rabbit hole of drug use.
Thank you, Christal. I appreciate you sharing that. I think that that's incredible that you had the courage to go and meet them. I can't imagine how hard that probably was. And your strength and all of that is incredible. So thank you for sharing that. And I hadn't heard the story about your most recent visit. So that's so awesome. I'm glad that it went well. We have a few questions lined up. So I will start with this question from Andrea. She says, anyone can answer this question on the panel. I've been in tears listening. Do you experience opposition from prosecutors and the media? And do you find that telling your life experiences changes their minds?
I'll answer that a little bit. Testifying in the Montana legislature, in the Judiciary Committee, I did experience that with when I was asked back after I'd given my testimony and then was invited back to answer questions. There was a legislator that had been pretty convinced that the death penalty was the way to go. And there was another person in the room who was very adamant about the death penalty, and he thought it should be have it happen much faster and swifter and, you know, just get it done with and everything. So we were both kind of on different sides of the view, and he was coming at it from his faith perspective too. But the way that I was able to respond to that made a difference to that one legislator, at least. And to say there's different ways of looking at some of these passages in the scriptures, Old Testament, New Testament, not necessarily that one's better than the other, but they build on each other, and that there's a central core in there of a redeeming love, and we keep growing in our understanding of what that's about. And it's not that you let somebody just get away with things or say that it was all right or not, but that there's a sense that love of God is present for the people who were carrying out the crucifixion of Jesus and for the thieves that were hanging next to him. And that there is a real love that is stronger than death. And it made a difference just in understanding, a different understanding maybe of how to interpret some of the scripture passages. So it was still legitimate to move into that direction of salvation and redemption. And even if the person is in prison the rest of their lives, because they're a danger to society, that love of God is still at work in them, or can be. I think another place that, real quickly, when I was part of the Wyoming Association of Churches, one of the things that we were doing, and I'm not sure that they're doing it now because a lot of things have changed, but they were leading a program in the prisons that was on helping people learn how to deal with things in a nonviolent way. And the Society of Friends was a big part of that too. So so they were bringing about changes too. And yeah, there have been several opportunities with people just being more thoughtful about the implications and from a faith perspective, and also just from the sense of humanity, how can we keep becoming a more human race, maybe, you know. We used to think it was okay to duel, you know, to solve conflicts between two guys, you know, we'll take it out and shoot it out, you know, and pardon me, but sometimes it seems like that's the way Montana's heading again right now. But anyway, you know, we keep trying to grow an understanding of what it means to be human and humane. I hope that helps a little.
Thank you.
How about you, Chris?
So for myself, when it comes to a faith-based understanding, I remember that was actually a part of my letter to the first offender. And it was, you know, Jesus looked across at the people that were stoning him and nailing him to the cross, and yet he still died for those sins. I was raised LDS, and my grandmother was one of the best women in the world. She taught me how to love even if somebody was deemed unlovable. She taught me that live Christ-like and treat others as you would want to be treated. And so I've had this question a couple times because my brother is definitely opposed to the death penalty, or he is pro-death penalty, where I'm like opposed. And so we have this debate quite a bit, and it gets somewhat entertaining, and we end up laughing about it by the end of it because, you know, really love conquers all, right? But he says eye for an eye. And I tell him, Jesus died on the cross to rectify all sins based off of our hearts. And who are we to judge as humans? Because all we know is our humanity, right? Where we have our Heavenly Father or our higher power that is really the ultimate judge. And he knows all of our struggles. He knows the mental illness. He knows the physical illnesses that we have. And he is the one to judge. Who are we to say, okay, you know, we're going to murder this person just as they murdered the other person. And does that make us any more guilty or any less guilty because we chose through the judicial system to murder another individual?
Thank you, Christal. One part of this question that I wanted to just touch briefly on was about opposition from prosecutors. And I think that there's a common misconception that the death penalty needs to continue to stay on the books as a law because prosecutors use it as a tool in the toolbox to get people to confess to crimes. And using the death penalty to secure plea bargains is not only unnecessary, it's incredibly dangerous. The threat of death increases the risk of convicting the innocent. There are documented cases of innocent people confessing to crimes that they did not commit simply by trying to avoid a death sentence. So they often spend years in prison on death row until the truth is uncovered. And this is why so many prosecutors believe that it is unethical to use the death penalty to force out a plea. So I just wanted to touch on that before we go to our next question from Senator Fred Baldwin. Thank you for joining us, Senator. Can you share the amount of dollars spent annually just to keep the death penalty on the books in Wyoming? So currently, our legislature has allocated $750,000 to the death penalty in Wyoming. But if we don't currently have an active death penalty case, but if we did, that number would increase because there's no way that that would be enough money to cover a death penalty trial. So that's something to keep in mind. I think we kind of answered this next one as well from Senator Baldwin. Are there friends or family in your lives who feel differently than you, and how do you discuss this with them? We want to quickly touch on that. We kind of already did a little bit, but I'll let you ladies take that.
In our family, we've had a lot of long discussions over the years. It's been 30 years now. Actually, her birthday was on Valentine's Day and she would have been 55. So we've had a long time to work through this. And at this point in my immediate family, we all feel the same as far as opposed to the death penalty. But it's taken time and a lot of listening and a lot of thinking and growing.
Thank you, Sue. Let's see, I'm gonna go to this next question from Cade Garner. I'm a reporter based out of Idaho and have a question for anyone. What do you think is the most common misconception though of those who support the death penalty? Oh, sorry, let me start that over. What do you think is the most common misconception those who do support the death penalty have of those who do not support the death penalty?
Well, maybe. Do you want me to go first? So some of the things that I get the most is, why would you waste your time on worrying about somebody that committed an offense? I get that I'm too soft-hearted, or that I just don't understand, that I'm not educated. So I think that that's a big misconception that people that are pro-life or pro-death penalty, come at me with. But I've also been asked from my own perspective. My dad actually asked me this question, and he goes, so do you look at it from both stances? Do you look at it as pro-death penalty and repeal the death penalty? And I honestly feel that for myself, I like to look at everything out of the box. When somebody comes and tells me that it's cheaper to put somebody to death than it is to keep them in prison, and why are we wasting tax money on somebody that shouldn't be living? Then there's always that common feud. And I think a lot of it comes down to financial understanding versus moral understanding. And I hope I answered that correctly.
And I think, you know, that I hear the kind of thing too, that people who oppose the death penalty are naive or too soft-hearted again. I don't feel that I am, but I that's the thing that I hear. And I think I've heard the thing about you take away a tool from a really important tool from the toolbox. You know, I've heard that argument many times, but it seems to come from the same people. And there are a lot of prosecutors who are finding other ways to keep a good full toolbox without having that, like you said, say times when that's really misused. I feel one, you know, to be honest, I feel like Montana and Wyoming are probably among the states that are a lot more careful about how the death penalty is used. But Montana is still right now pushing back for more use of the death penalty. So it's a constant thing to try to prove how tough people are, and that this is a way to solve your problems. But again, it gets back to that modeling of using death to be the way that we solve our problems. And I'm really concerned about some of the things happening this year in our own legislature but I don't want to go there because this is about Wyoming. Maybe Wyoming can set a really good example for Montana is what I'm hoping.
Thank you, Sue. Hopefully we can too. Hopefully we'll be the next state to repeal. Yep. Another thing to touch on with this as well is that I think that sometimes people believe if you don't agree with the death penalty or you believe in repealing it, that we don't understand violence and don't believe in accountability. And I don't believe that that's the case. A month ago, we heard from death row exoneree Ron Kiney, and he kept saying something that really stuck with me. He was 9 days away from being executed before the actual murderer came forward and confessed. And something that Ron continuously said was that life in prison without the possibility of parole was a much worse punishment in his mind than the death penalty. So when we don't understand accountability, we don't believe in accountability, that's not true, because the alternative to the death penalty is life in prison without the possibility of parole, which means these individuals are never going to leave prison. So I think that that's important too. Let's see, we have another question. Is there a bill in front of the legislature this year? There, a bill has not been filed yet, but you can count on seeing one. And hopefully after Virginia's great news of repealing their death penalty, Wyoming will have similar outcome.
Montana has a couple. One that's still coming up yet is to repeal the death penalty. The other one is to make a different kind of chemical available to put people to death. I don't know, put antifreeze in them or something. It's not, that's where we are right now as far as Montana, because I know that we start our sessions sooner in this, you know, winter than you do, so.
Yeah. Let's see, do we have any more questions?
May I bring up one more topic? Normally I talk about this and it just totally blew over my head this time. But when we're talking about victims of violent crimes, the Victims Compensation Fund, that alone, when it comes to trying to apply for those fundings for counseling, travel expenses, time off of work, it is a hardship on the victims, and that actually causes quite the trauma and stress. And, you know, you're kind of at a loss when you're doing it. I will tell you that when my husband's trial was going on, when they decided that they were going to do the plea deal, I was unable to go to that. I was unable to read my victim's impact statement, which probably wouldn't have done much good at that point in time anyways. But because I knew it was going to take so long to get reimbursed, I knew as a mother that my responsibility was to put food in my children's mouth versus to go down to read a 10-minute statement and to look that man in the face and be in court. The funding that is allocated to the Victims Compensation Fund isn't enough. There isn't enough workers, there isn't enough coordinators to help process those. And that actually creates harm as well to the victim's family members. So I would like people to think about that as well. It's not just the trauma from going through all of these court hearings. It is also the trauma of going through the Victims Compensation Fund. And if we do put them on death row and then they try to appeal the process, then what is that doing? That's scratching off those scabs. And inmates have that right through the Constitution to appeal any sentencing that they may have.
Yeah, that's a very good point, Christal. And I can't remember, I think Sue, it might have, one of you earlier said that you've heard from others who are for the death penalty say, let's just speed up the process and execute them faster so that it doesn't cost as much money to taxpayers and that it doesn't prolong the process for victims' family members. And it's important to remember that under the Constitution, we all are entitled to due process. And there have been individuals that have been exonerated of all charges on their very last appeal. So that's, I mean, it's very important, and the process is the way that it is because it works, and individuals have been exonerated on their very last appeal.
Yeah, I was the one that brought that up, and I think that's a really important point. And I think it kind of brings out the reality that like in our case, there wasn't even ever any charges. We pretty well figured out what happened, and people have made enough comments here and there, but it wasn't enough to make a case in court. And it's as though we're all human, and sometimes prosecutors or police officers arrest the wrong person for whatever reason. It seems like that was the right person at the time, obviously, but and press on with it because they can't back off. Sometimes they don't, sometimes there is no arrest and the person just walks. And it's possible for any one of us to make a mistake. My husband was a deputy sheriff for several years. And I don't want to go into all the details of my daughter's death and the investigation afterward, but the people who did the final investigation for us were some of the best in the Northwest. And he was absolutely convinced she didn't take her own life, that she did not commit suicide. It's pretty hard to hold a .357 to the back of your head, you know. But there wasn't the kind of evidence that they needed to make a case in court. So sometimes they get the wrong person, sometimes they don't get the right person. But if you do the death penalty, it's done and there's no going back. And if the only way to find justice is to take that other life, then the courts don't do it. Then what does that say? You know, who gets to go do it then? TV shows, and it might happen that the family member goes after the murderer, but in real life, that doesn't work so well.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a really good point, Sue. And to date, there is over 170 individuals that have been exonerated from death row since the reinstatement of the death penalty in 1973, which is huge. So that equates to about out of every 9 individuals on death row, one has been exonerated, which is alarming to me. And that was one of the biggest reasons why I became opposed to the death penalty, because I think the risk of executing an innocent person is too great, and one too life is one too many, in my opinion. And that's something that I think that we really need to take into consideration when looking at repealing the death penalty. All right, I think.
I saw, there's a comment about when the defendant and victims are related, families are even further torn apart. I can absolutely see that. And then when there is a child involved, usually that child doesn't understand and start really, as a child victim, I will say that a child doesn't really start to process that until about 18 years old, when they're old enough to understand it. Because I know that as adults, it's really hard to sit there and talk to a child and know what to say, what not to say, because you're afraid that you're gonna further harm that child. So when a child already has to cope with a murder, and then you put another person that is related to that child, say it's two parents, mom or dad was murdered and the other one is now being put up for execution. I mean, what kind of trauma is that gonna cause? And if we don't start looking at that kind of trauma, we're gonna start seeing these kids that are going through this trauma and not being given that trauma-informed care that they need, where they're gonna be more likely to have that higher violence offense within their adolescent years and young adulthood. So we're gonna just continue that cycle. So I think that we need to start educating people about the childhood trauma aspect of a murder victim or even nieces and nephews, because it is something that is rippling out. My dad used an amazing, and I talk about my dad all the time. I'm really sorry, but he's my hero. So if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be who I am today. But he used to tell me, if you are looking at a steel pool of water and you put a drop in it, what's going to happen? It's going to ripple out, right? We see all the rings and it goes all the way to the shore. And that's exactly what violent crimes do. And that is exactly what an execution would do to any of the families involved with that.
That is a really good point, Christal. It is just a continuous cycle of trauma for those involved. Thank you for pointing that out. We do have another question. How do you talk with a person who believes in pro-life at birth, but believes in putting a person to death, even a guilty person? This question may be religious, but I'm curious. Thank you for asking that, Carla. And I can start to kick us off with this answer, just because it's something that I often talk a lot about. As a conservative Republican, I believe in, I'm pro-life across the board. So I believe that life begins at conception and ends at natural death. So often when I'm faced or talking to other Republicans about being pro-life, I acknowledge that and say I'm pro-life across the board, which means natural death. And I don't believe that the death penalty is natural death. So that's how I look at it. But I'm interested to see if Sue or Christal look at it differently.
I appreciate the Roman Catholic Church stand on that too, that consistent ethic for life. A person that worked in public health for a long time too, I know that there are times when abortion is necessary medical procedure, which some people might disagree with, but I've seen pregnancies and fetuses that have been really badly misshapen and needed to have for the mother's health. And sometimes it's for the mental health So I get it from the other side, because I come out so strong against the death penalty, and I have people that are very, very, very anti-abortion in any circumstances. And so then they push me because I don't like the idea of abortion, and I don't think it should be just a method of birth control or anything like that. But I believe the whole thing with the conception, and that's when that new life starts. You know, you work with people that are infertile or whatever, and they try so hard to get to be pregnant, and that first little kick of life, you know, I mean, it's a little spark. It's so longed for and hoped for. So I have to agree that life starts then and needs to be treated with honor and dignity all the way through the end of natural life. And like I said, I've seen God at work in the lives of people that have been condemned to life in prison, and still their lives can be of value and make a difference for good. So I still think that whole life ethic, is cherishing life all the way through, is really critical.
Thank you, Sue. Well, we are approaching 7:00, so I am going to wrap us up and close out. Again, just want to thank Sue and Christal, both of you, for joining us tonight and sharing your stories. You both are the epitome of strength and dignity, and I really appreciate you both coming and sharing this with all of us tonight. And for being so brave and talking about this, your stories, I can't imagine what you guys have both gone through, but I really appreciate everything that you're doing going forward to help repeal the death penalty. And I truly believe that we can get it done this year. With that being said, I am going to have Sarah put a link into the chat for everyone to follow if you'd like to go to our website and sign up to get emails, get involved with the campaign to end the death penalty in Wyoming. You can also reach out to your lawmakers through our website as well. And that's really important. I would really highly suggest everyone to reach out to their lawmakers if you haven't already, to let them know that you support repealing the death penalty and get them on the books and ask if they are supporting the death penalty this legislative session as well. We are really close and we just need a few more votes and we can get it done. And I truly believe that with everyone's help that we can do it this year. So thank you again to everyone for joining us and those links. Thank you, Sarah, for getting those posted. And thank you again to Sue and Christal so much.
Thank you.